study circle meeting on recent amendments and issues in TDS and TCS provisions under the Income Tax Act. Recently, some amendments have been made in TDS provisions, like deducting higher rate of TDS in case of non-filing of an income tax return by specified persons. To make us understand in detail this amendment and along with that few other amendments in TDS and TCS, we have with us our own member, CA Hetal Dinit Gada. Let us all welcome her. And I now request Chintan Rambe to please play our ICM anthem. Thank you.
यैष सुप्तेषु जाग्रति यैष सुप्तेषु जाग्रति कामं 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 कामंशो पुरुषो निर्विमाणः निर्विमाणः तदेव शुक्रं तदेव शुक्रदब्रह्म तदब्रह्म तदेवामृतमुच्यते तस्मिन् लोकः शतः सर्वतदूनाच्यतीतश्च नात्यतीतश्च एतद्वैता 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 एतद्वैता
Thank you, Chintan. Now I'll request committee member Amit Cheda to please introduce our today's speaker, Hetal Gada.
Thank you, Jigar Bhai. CA Hetal Vineet Gada. She's qualified in the year 2010. She's associated since more than a decade with the firm CGCA and Associates LLP, formerly known as UKG and Associates, a chartered accountancy firm in Dadar. Her area of specialization is direct taxation. She's also engaged in audits, litigation, tax filings, and compliances. She's a part of managing committee of CVO Chartered and Cost Accountants Association. She's written various articles in CVOCA News and Views, has taken lectures for student members of CVOCA, and has also been a group leader in RRC of Dadari CP Study Circle for direct taxation paper in the year 2021. With this short introduction, I would like to welcome you, CA Hetal Gada.
Thank you, Ami. Over to you, Hetal.
Yeah. Thank you, Jigar Bhai. Thank you, Ami, for this brief introduction. And I thank you, coordinators Chintan Rambia and conveners of Dadar ECP Study Circle for giving me this opportunity to present my seminar on recent amendments in TDS and TCS provisions. I'll just share my screen. Yeah, is my screen visible?
Yes, Hetal.
Yeah, thank you. Hope everyone is safe, fine and healthy. And hope everyone is taking the precautions in these tough times of COVID. I'm sure we will all together will sail through this tough times as well. Just a disclaimer before starting off with the PPT. This PPT should be used as a reference for looking at the amendments to TDS and TCS provisions. But it is always advisable to check the respective provisions verbatim when you are practically going to be applying and determining the tax liability, because there are constant updations in the law and there are various clarifications or notifications issued by the board time and again. So maybe when you practically apply it at that point of time, you need to see things again and reread it. So that was just a disclaimer from my end. The TDS provisions and TCS provisions were introduced by the government with a perspective of ease and early collection of taxes. Now, the date from introduction of these provisions till the date today, there have been vast and huge changes and huge changes in the scope of the way TDS provisions have been brought in. The ideally scenario by the government is to shift the burden from them on the taxpayers. But with these complexities being multifold year on year and amendment being there in these provisions in almost every finance bill, it needs to be seen that by doing this, where is the government trying to be nearby even for ease of doing business? So I would say never ever take TDS or TCS provisions very lightly. Extreme caution and vigilance needs to be taken by every client. It's not a mere compliance, but the way provisions have been enacted now, it has just created more and more complexities, which we will see in the slides to come. So I begin with my PPT. What I have tried to cover is TDS provisions that have got amended, TDS and TCS provisions that have got amended in Finance Act 21. We'll cover that first because that is the latest amendment. And then we will go with Finance Act 2020 amendments. I have tried to cover only those amendments which are going to be applicable to us day in, day out. I mean, there are much more amendments which might not be applicable at our daily practice. So I've just tried to cover that. Yeah. The first provision is section 194P. Now this is quite a welcome amendment that has been brought in by the government. In this, they are trying to relax the return filing provision for specified senior citizens. So if you check, specified senior citizen is a person, resident individual, emphasis on the resident word, who is of the age of 75 years or more. So we now have one more category of senior citizens to be kept in mind. So earlier we have this slab rate for 60 years of age of senior citizen and 80 years. Now for this specific provision, 75 years has been added as one more category. Such senior, specified senior citizen should be of the age of 75 years or more, and they should be having income from pension in the bank in which it is getting interest income. So only two type of income is permitted to such kind of people: pension income and the bank in which this pension income is coming in, only the interest income in that bank. And the third condition is, if such kind of specified senior citizen is qualifying, then he will have to give a declaration in the prescribed format. That prescribed format has not yet been notified or given by the government. So we wait till this comes into play. Now, who will be the person who will be responsible for deducting TDS? It will be the notified banking company. So any banking company which is notified under the Central Government Act, he will be eligible to deduct TDS on a specified senior citizen. Now, while computing this, the bank will consider the income of pension and interest. It will give deduction under Chapter 6A, rebate if applicable under 87A, and then compute the tax as per the rates applicable in force. Okay. Once this qualification or this eligibility is satisfied, then such a specified senior citizen need not file his income tax return for that particular year. And this is applicable from 1st April 2021. Now, interest from saving banks of that account where pension income is coming in, and if there are FDs maintained in that particular bank account, and if there is interest income on this FD bank account, I understand in my view, that should be eligible for deduction under this section, and no return filing accordingly. Another thing here could be if such a kind of a person is earning exempt income, whether he'll be eligible to qualify as a specified senior citizen under 194P and not file return. So exempt income could be in the nature of agricultural income or an interest on PPF, or could be share from partnership firm. So if we go by the literal meaning or the wordings of this provision, then it seems that only these two types of income are covered, even though those exempt income do not come under the computation mechanism. So literal reading, someone might say this might not such a kind of a person who is earning exempt income might not be eligible under these provisions. But if a liberal view is taken to say that if the intention of the government is to ease out such specified senior citizens from complying from the return filing and to keep them away from the hassle of filing returns, then maybe if such a liberal view is taken with the intention as to why this section has been brought in, maybe that can be considered as allowable in his case. So time and again, we'll get to know whether how is the government thinking. Next could be when the computation is being made by such a notified banking company, then he will have to determine whether what is more beneficial to the specified senior citizen, whether the old regime or whether the new regime. Because under the old regime, you will be eligible for Chapter 6A deductions and rebate under 87A. But when you shift or decide to go under the new regime under Section 115BAC, then in that case, none of the deductions will be applicable. So ideally, the bank should take into consideration what the senior citizen has done in the previous years, and he should always try and apply the regime which is more beneficial to the specified senior citizen. Then, so if another case could be where a specified senior citizen is having two bank accounts, maybe he doesn't have any other income, purely interest income from the respective bank accounts. Will he be eligible for such an exemption of not filing return? So again, literal reading of the section says that pension income and interest income in the same specified bank. So ideally, if you receive a pension income in one of the banks, so then by that virtue, second bank should also not be allowed to you. So in case there are such kind of banks and the specified senior citizen is declaring that he has two banks, maybe the bank might not consider this provision and he might have to file a return of income. Say for an example, if specified senior citizen does not declare the bank account, maybe with the separate banks, he gives independent declaration saying, I have only this bank with me. Then obviously the bank might not know whether he has a bank account with any other bank unless there is some mechanism in the brought in by the tax department. So in such case, he will still be eligible to claim. But if the department for whatever reasons comes to know that such a mischief has happened, or maybe such a thing has happened, he might want request the specified senior citizen to file a return of income, or maybe he might come out with any reassessment proceedings or probably best judgment to determine his income. Now declaration, so to take care of such a situation, maybe the declaration or the format of the declaration which the government tries to bring in, they might have to incorporate something to say that the specified senior citizen declares whether he has another bank account or not. Okay, so this was in terms of TDS in case of specified senior citizen, where the benefit is given for not filing return of income. We go to the next section, which is 206AB, which is TDS for non-filers of income tax return. So we had similar provisions for 206AA, where when the government wanted the taxpayers to obtain and furnish PAN, and in order to execute those requirements of furnishing PAN, the department or the central government had imposed a condition that if the PAN is not given when to the other party who's going to deduct your TDS, then higher rate of TDS will be applicable. Yeah. So in case of
I have muted all, and Hetal, you can mute your unmute your on.
Yeah.
So, request participants to please unmute yourselves and stop their videos so that you know everybody, no bandwidth is there, and even there is no disturbance to the lecturer. Thanks.
Yeah. Thank you. So, I was just saying that 206AA was a very successful execution at the end of the department, where people who couldn't produce the TDS, people who could not produce PAN number, were subject to a higher rate of TDS, and fearing that higher rate of deduction, people started obtaining and furnishing PAN. And if you read the memorandum, the government very clearly says that yes, that has been successful while executing. Let us try it when we are doing it for non-filing of income tax returns. So very similar provision has been executed in section 206AB. It's a new section which will be applicable from 1st July 2021, where what kind of transactions will be covered? So TDS deducted under any of the sections mentioned under chapter 7B, they shall be covered, except this 4-6 list of sections which they have specified: TDS on salary, TDS on accumulated balance in PF of an employee, winning from lottery, winning from race, income from investment in securitization trust, and payment of certain amounts in cash. Okay, I'll tell you the reason why these might not be included. We first just understand what the section is all about. So to whom will this section apply, as in who, in whose case can this section be triggered? So it will be a specified person who has not filed income tax return for the immediately two preceding previous years. First condition. Second condition, the due date for filing the original return. Kindly note, the original return has expired when the payer is deducting that tax. And the third condition is aggregate of TDS and TCS provisions is more than 50,000 in each of these two previous years. So the two previous years for which we are testing the income tax return file, the TDS and TCS put together exceeds 50,000 in his case. This is the condition. In this, if a non-resident who does not have PE in India is exempted, or maybe is for him, this section does not apply. And in specified person, everyone is covered. There is no restriction on individual HUF, because the intention of the government is every entity should file a return. The rate of TDS will be as following: three higher of the three conditions that they've given, rate in the relevant section. So two times the rate of the relevant section, say under 194J, if the rate is 10%. So two times of that, and 194J, may I have a payee who has not filed return of income, then the rate will be 20%. Or rates in force, or 5%, whichever is higher. Now, there could be a scenario where a person has PAN, he has produced that PAN, then in that case, and he has filed his return of income. So only 206AA will apply to him, and not 206AA is satisfied, and 206AB is not satisfied because he has not filed the return of income. Now, there could be a scenario where 206AA and AB both are satisfied, meaning the person does not have a PAN, or has a PAN but has not procured one, and he has not filed the income tax returns for two previous financial years. So if I have to test this section as on 1st July 2021, then I need to check whether the other person has filed return for financial year ending March 20 and financial year ending March 19, because 1st July is now, March 21 returns will now follow. So in that case, we were saying that why these sections have been excluded. One reason could be these sections already have higher rate of tax. If you see the respective rates in these sections, they are already somewhere around 25-30. Salary, balance in PF and all, they are at the rates that are applicable, or rates in force. Winning of lottery, horse race is again 20% or 30%. Same is the case with LBC. And in the case of 194N, this is a section where if a person withdraws cash from his bank account for more than 1 crore, then 194N, the rate of 2% is triggered on his transaction. Now, there is one condition in that if the person has not filed his return of income, a person who is withdrawing cash from bank and he has not filed his previous 3 years return, then in that case, for him, the limit will reduce from 1 crore to 20 lakhs to test the applicability of 194N. And if his withdrawal is more than 1 crore, then it is 5%. So if the withdrawal is more than 20 lakhs but up to 1 crore, the rate is 2% for him. If it is beyond 1 crore, then it is 5%. So this section has been excluded because there is already a condition to tax at a higher rate. So this is that section. One more thing in this is 194IB, where an individual or HUF who's not liable to tax audit, if he is paying rent to a person beyond an amount of 50,000 a month, then he is liable to deduct TDS under this section. The TDS will be deducted in the last month of the financial year if he's the tenant till that time, or the last month of tenancy if he gives up for the tenancy in between the year. So here a specific amendment has been made to say that if such a case happens where the rent is being paid to the to the opposite party who's giving the property on rent, and if he does not file his return of income, then the formula will definitely apply, but it will be restricted to the TDS amount which shall not exceed the last month of rent paid. So all in all, this is the section. Similar provisions have been enacted for TCS as well, again in lines with 206CC, which was similar to 206AA, PAN not available. So because I have a section for 206AA corresponding to 206CC, I have a similar thing for non-filers in TCS as well. Same provisions, same conditions. The only difference will be if I'm collecting TCS under any of the provisions of 206C, and if the other party has not filed return for two immediately preceding previous years, the due date has expired, and the aggregate TDS and TCS is more than 50,000, then the rate supply will be two times the rate in the relevant section of 206C, that is TCS, or 5%, whichever is higher. Again, the applicability is 1st July 2021. Let us look at some issues or considerations in this section. Now, belated return. I'll go back to the provision. If you see, one of the conditions is that the taxpayer, if he has not filed original return, or if he has not filed the return within the original due date, that is the due date specified under 139(1). So what if in a case I defaulted on paying on filing my income tax return for 139(1), under 139(1) time limits, but I filed a belated return under 139(4) or 5, I'm sorry, I just don't remember which section, but if I have filed a belated return for the previous 2 years for which I have to check this condition, I will still have to face a consequence of higher rate of tax deduction, because the section very clearly says the due date of original return has expired on the date of deduction. So probably the government wants every assessee to file the returns in a timely manner, not even a belated return, and hence this provision. Second could be where out of the two previous years, 1 year I have filed the return, 1 year I have not filed the return, then what? Then I am out of this provision, because the conditions here are both the, there's a cumulative condition that both return filing for both the years, if not done, then this trigger is, this section is triggered. But if in case I satisfy one of the years where I have filed a return, then this provision does not become applicable. This is a kind of, kind of making the provision redundant. So this is the present provision as it is. Now, another very important thing that needs to be kept in mind is the section literally says if the return has not been filed by the opposite party. But maybe the intention of the government is very true and very right, that it wants to encourage people to file the return and all. But they have maybe missed out onto the fact that they've not checked or put the condition that if a person who is genuinely not liable to file a return of income, should he also be pulled in this kind of double, twice the rate of TDS or not? So what could be the scenarios where this kind of situation can happen? So we just looked at section 194P, which says that if specified senior citizen is satisfying those three conditions that we said, that he's above 75 and all, in that case, he's not required to file his return of income. Now, if in a particular year, he does not give a declaration, and in the previous 2 years, he was not liable to file the return of income, he will now come under this provision So the law is somewhere not trying to consider that he was genuinely not required to file a return of income, but has, due to this situation, has not been able to come out of this scenario. The second situation could be non-residents of or foreign companies are not required to file return of income in India by virtue of exemption granted under 115A5. So section 115A subsection 5 exempts non-residents and foreign companies for such a kind of deduction. So they have not filed their income tax return for the previous 2 years. So in this scenario also, if they are liable to deduct, someone is trying to deduct the TDS in their case, then it's a genuine case or where they were exempted by law but still are covered under this provision of double the rate of TDS. Next example could be e-commerce operator, which we will now see in the coming slides, deduction under section 194O, where a farmer is coming on the platform of e-commerce operator and he is trying to sell his agricultural produce. Now, a farmer, because he is selling his agriculture, he's selling his agricultural produce and earns agricultural income, which is an exempt income, he is not liable to file his return of income. And in such a scenario, if e-commerce operators tries to deduct TDS, then he will check and see if he has filed or not. And obviously, by virtue of law, he was not required. Again, he'll come into this problem of double deduction. Next could be a scenario where a senior citizen was having only interest income, which is not exceeding the maximum chargeable limit in all these years, or maybe this previous 2 years. Now in the next year, he forgets to give his 15E declaration that he does not have income chargeable to income exceeding the maximum chargeable limit. Now the bank will definitely not go and ask each and every individual as such. So the bank might just deduct TDS on the interest income that he is earning for that particular year. And when the bank will check that he has not filed his return of income, then again, he has to face this consequences. So these are a few scenarios where genuinely the law didn't require, there could be much more scenarios. I have just listed a few. So where the law per se didn't require me to file the return of income, I was not liable to file the return of income. But so the government will have to come out with some way to tackle this situation of not liable to file the return of income. Next is the wordings used. So there is a third condition which we discussed was TDS and TCS in the case of the payee exceeds 50,000. So the words here is in his case, which is creating a little confusion or maybe discussion everywhere. Here the discussion of the confusion is this way, that do I need to check this 50,000 limit as a payer with the other party with my transactions? That may, meaning that if I have deducted TDS and TCS in the previous 2 years, each year being 50,000, or do I need to check that apart from me, there are other parties also who have deducted TDS and TCS in the previous 2 years, all aggregating to 50,000. Now, in this scenario, what will happen is, I am not in control of the data of what the other party is doing. So the better view should always be that it should be seen that I have, if I have a transaction with him, which is beyond 50,000, or I have deducted TDS and TCS put together in his case, which is beyond 50,000 in the previous two financial years, then this should apply. And I think that is the view which should be taken as well. Then right now, the day, so if you see the date of application of this particular section is 1st July 2021. At least till now, there has been no clarification from the government or the CBDT to say that how will a person be in a position to understand or procure an ITR copy or know that whether the other person has filed his return of income or not. So presently, what I will have to do is I'll have to ask the other party to give me his ITR copy. Now, we have seen this practically in at the time of scrutinies when the assessing officer calls in for an ITR copy for the maybe a debt, maybe a purchase party or the seller or the loan party. Not every entity is agreeing to give us this, and they are very resistant because obviously their data is confidential. They would not want to share with us. So in such a scenario, either they will have to face the consequence unless and until government comes out with some clarification on this one. Now, just we just discussed about 194N, where banks are supposed to check whether the other party has filed his return of income for previous 3 years or not. So there is on the reporting portal, which is an insight portal which we generally use for SFT transactions. On those portals, the government has provided a facility of ITR filing compliance check to such scheduled commercial banks to check whether the other party has whether the other party has filed 3 years return or not. Some mechanism has been drawn out for this particular downloading of the data of whether the other party has filed the return or not. So I think maybe the date of first implementation of 1st July could be of some preparation from the end of the government to give us some mechanism or some login, some tab which helps us determine whether the other party is whether the other party has actually filed income tax return for the previous 2 years. So now a scenario could be where as on the date of provision, I have not filed the return of income because the due date of the return of income has not expired. So in such a case, what do I do? I need to check three conditions. One of the conditions being whether the original return date has not expired and I have filed a return of income. So in that case, maybe we'll have to call in for some declaration from the other party to understand that whether he is in the intention to file the return of income. Maybe that will help us come out of our liability if the declaration is in place that if I'm put as SSE in default for non-deduction at a higher rate, then I can always say that I had a genuine reason of non-deducting because I had taken a declaration. And if the other party is not filing, then maybe I shouldn't be made liable to the consequences of it. So this was the provisions for 206 AB and 206 CCA, non-filing of return of income. The most talked about section 194Q, I think it's making rounds and discussions everywhere. Very important to understand for big value transactions. 194Q, purchase of goods. There's a similar provision under TCS under section 206 C1H, which was brought in by Finance Act 2020. Now I will pick up both of them together because somewhere or the other they are interconnected and a lot many things we'll see in the coming slides. So first I'll try to explain what 194Q is all about. So 194Q is TDS to be deducted on purchase of goods. Here the buyer is a person or the threshold limit given for the buyer is a person who makes sales, turnover or gross receipts in the immediately preceding financial year. So if this section is applicable from 1st July 2021, and if I have to test this section as on 1st July 2021, I will check the turnover in the immediately preceding previous year, which is March 21. And whom am I selling it to? So the seller has to be a resident. The section very specifically says that the goods should be purchased from a seller who is resident resident in India. The threshold limit is given as 50 lakhs. So the value or aggregate value of the purchases, if exceeding 50 lakhs, then this section is triggered. And the rate of tax is going to be 0.1% on purchases which will exceed 50 lakhs. So the government, while explaining this provision under the memorandum, has said that it is giving a TDS rate of a very low rate of 0.1%. Obviously, the quantum or the amount of 50 lakhs is way too high. So 0.1% is reasonable enough. Now, when shall this TDS be triggered, or what could be the time of deductibility would be at the time of payment or credit, whichever is earlier, just like we see for any other section. Applicability we've discussed. Now, when will this provision not be applicable? So two things. If TDS has been deducted under any other provisions of the Act, then this section does not get triggered. If TCS is collected under 206C, so there are various sections under 206C which calls for TCS collection. But if 206C1H is applicable, then 194Q is a mandatory provision. So between 194Q and 2061H, so 2061H is TCS collected by seller on sale of goods. 194Q is TDS collected by or deducted by the purchaser on purchase of goods. So only if these two sections are triggered for TDS, then 194Q will not come in play. So a few considerations here. Now, 206C and 194Q, the very intention of getting this provision is a little tricky, because if the government wanted to understand or get the data on purchase and sales, GST is already giving you, so the data is already coming in from the GST provisions. So one fails to understand as to why these provisions have come into play despite GST being there. So time and again, we'll get to know why these provisions have been enacted. Now, in case of imports of goods, in case of an import of goods, the buyer is an Indian party because he is importing from a country outside India. He is purchasing goods from a seller who is a resident outside India. And by virtue of the section, the seller has to be a resident. So in case of imports of goods, this TDS will not be triggered. Export of goods, what will happen in that case? So in case of an export of goods, seller is an Indian entity and buyer is a person who is buying goods who is resident outside India. Now, section per se does not speak anything on the buyer when specifically for seller he has mentioned as resident. But in case of a buyer, it could be both because section is silent on that. Also, correspondingly, there is an amendment in 204. Now, 204 is a list of persons who will be considered as person responsible for paying. So the words used in all the TDS sections are person responsible of paying. So that has been defined under 204. And in the Finance Act 2020 itself, it has been amended to include a non-resident, his authorized person or his agent. So any authorized person who is working on behalf of or taking instruction from non-resident, or an agent who is doing transaction on his behalf in India, or a non-resident who is doing transaction outside India. All these are covered under person responsible for paying. So unless and until the board comes out with a clarification or the board exempts such kind of transactions, till that time there is no choice but export of goods will be subject to TDS under 194Q. And this is going to create a lot of hassle because nowhere under law the non-resident is required to know what TDS provisions apply to me. So this could be an issue unless and until clarified by the board before 1st of July 2021. We just discussed 206 AA, AAB. In that case, if I happen to purchase goods from a person who does not give me PAN number or who has not filed his return of income, the other conditions being satisfied in those respective sections of 206 AA and AB, then I will have to deduct TDS at a higher rate. Now, ideally, under 206 AA, the highest rate was 20%, but the Act has amended that for the purpose of 194Q, the rate of 20% will be replaced by 5%. So at all point in time, all put together, my rate under 194Q being 0.1%, my highest rate under non-PAN cases being 5%, and my highest rate under non-income tax filer rate being 5%, my everything put together, the highest will be the highest rate of TDS will be 5%. So this needs to be checked and kept in mind when we are doing a transaction with the other party. Now, generally, I can make in the other sections, I can make an application to the assessing officer to procure a lower TDS certificate. However, under 194Q, no such provision has been, no such leeway has been given, and correspondingly under section 197, which is for lower deduction of lower certificate of TDS, no corresponding amendment has been made to include 194Q as one of the TDS sections. Similarly, in 206(1)H, which is for TCS on sale of goods, no such provision is available. So which means when I am purchasing from a seller, the seller will not be able to apply for a lower TDS. And when I am selling, the purchaser will not be able to apply for a lower TDS certificate. Assessing in default. So a lot many times when the purchaser fails or the party who is expending or making payment fails to deduct TDS, a provision of assessing in default is triggered in his hand. However, he will not be considered as assessing default if the four conditions are satisfied, and 194Q very well allows such kind of a condition where the other party, which is the seller in my case, has filed his return of income. He has offered that income for tax. He has paid taxes on such income, and a certificate to that extent has been given. So even under 206C1H, I'll be able to take this position of coming out of SSE in default. Nevertheless, interest under 201A for TDS and interest under 2067 for TCS will definitely apply to the purchaser and seller as the case may. So now an interplay when, so both the sections coexist. 2061H was brought into play on 1st October 20. And when 194Q was introduced in this Finance Act 2021, the government didn't withdraw 2061H. So which means both the sections as on they are coexisting and they're on law, very much on the statute. We'll just try to compare very much similar rates, requirement and all. So as we discussed, 194Q is purchases, 2061H is sale. The limit for both the conditions is where here where the liability is on the buyer should have gross turnover receipts of 10 crores or more. Similarly, the seller will have gross turnover receipts of 10 crores or more in the immediately preceding previous years. Limit for the threshold limit is the same, 50 lakhs of the transaction, more than 50 lakhs rather. Rate will be the same, 0.1% on transaction exceeding this. Again, as we discussed, 206AAB applies. Then the one different difference which is there in the two section is under 194Q, TDS is deductible at the time of credit or payment, whichever is earlier. But under 2061H, which is TCS, it is deductible at the time of receipt of the consideration by the seller. So note this difference between the two sections. Now, when this amendment came in, so 2061H already specified that if tax has been collected by the purchaser on purchase of goods and he has deducted TDS also, then the seller will not be under an obligation to deduct to collect TCS under 2061H, which means the onus is shifted mandatorily on the buyer, which is 194Q. Buyer has to, so the check always will be where the buyer first will check whether he is liable to. If he is liable to, he has to deduct. But in a scenario where he is liable to but he has not deducted, then 206C1H again says that then you will as a seller be required to collect TCS. So 194Q mandatory. If that is mandatory and deducted, well and good. Not deducted, then 2061H gets triggered. Applicability, as we discussed, 1st July 2021. Probably the government wants the industry to be prepared as to these provisions, and hence the provision applicable from 1st July 2020. Who are exempted in this category? Comparing both the scenarios. So under 194Q, we discussed import of goods is not triggered in this. Similarly, 206C1H, the section specifically says that import of goods will not be covered. So both are on parity. Then there are a few government entities which have been specified in both. Now, just to be noted that when purchase is made from the government entity, I am, as a purchaser, not required to deduct TDS under 194Q. But if I am the seller and the other party, which is the government, these entities, the government entities, is a buyer, then they are still required to deduct TDS under 194Q. Then export of goods, 206CH very clearly says in the section itself that it will not be applicable. Yet, we are yet to receive some clarification on 194Q. Till not said it is applicable. And we discussed the exemptions or when TDS under 194Q will not be applicable. Similarly, under 206C1H, the section says that 206C1, where you have list of goods like alcohol, maybe liquor or timber woods or scrap, that is covered under 2061. 1F is for motor vehicle and 1G is for LRS and overseas tour package. If TCS is applicable in these sections, 206C1H will not apply. And like we said, 194Q is applicable, 2061H will not apply. So this is a brief comparison between the two. let us look at a scenario when only the buyer will be liable to 194 crore. So that could be a scenario where the buyer is having turnover more than 10 crores, assuming 50 lakhs threshold is reached, and the seller does not have a turnover of more than 10 crores in the immediately preceding previous year. In such a scenario, only 194 crore will apply. Vice versa, in 206(c)(1)(h), if buyer's turnover does not exceed, but seller's turnover exceeds, given the condition that 50 lakhs is fulfilled, then only the seller will be subject to, only 206(c)(1)(h) will be triggered. One more scenario where only 206(c)(1)(h) could be triggered would be purchases made before 1st July. The buyer has credited the account to the seller prior to 1st July, but the receipt of the amount by the seller is post 1st July. So in that case, again, only the seller will be liable to collect TCS, because prior to 1st July, the section of 194Q was not active or not effective. Now, scenarios where both could be applicable. So all the threshold limits are fulfilled by all of them, buyer also, purchaser also, and stock 50 lakhs of transaction is triggered. Then in that case, this applies. Both the section apply. 194Q will prevail and 206CH will take a backstand, as we discussed. Now, practically what happens is, when this section was executed, 206(1)(h), when it came into play from 1st October, then on a conservative view, none of the parties waited for, or none of the sellers waited for the amounts to be received in my bank. Rather, whenever the practice has been followed this way, that even as charters, we advise our clients that it is always better to do it at the time of doing that sales transaction. So the practically every seller who is raising a sale invoice, he will issue a TCS also at, he will collect TCS at that point in time only, just to avoid any consequences at a later point in time. Now, what will happen if this happens, if suppose say both the parties are not aware. So even the buyer, assuming this transaction happens post 1st July, the buyer and seller are exceeding the threshold limit, and the transaction is also exceeding the threshold limit. The buyer obviously will be under the mandate to do TDS, but the seller has a practice of doing it at the time of raising an invoice. Then both the parties will be, one party will do TDS, the other party will do TCS. So in that case, there'll be double taxation on the same amount of transaction. Then second thing could be cash flow issues. Say the purchaser has deducted TDS, and the buyer, in addition to the amount, so he will be receiving a short amount, because some portion of the amount will be given to the government on his behalf. So the balance, so TDS is already deducted, he's going to get shortfall of that amount, plus when he has to deposit TCS, that he will for that point in time have to temporarily put in from his pocket only. So there could be a possibility of cash issues where margins are very low on such purchase sale transactions. So seller is going to suffer a little bit, because TDS is already deducted and he'll have to pull out extra money by way of TCS. And all the more worse if the buyer refuses to reimburse that TCS. So that could be a problem. Ledger reconciliation. Again, like we discussed in this scenario, the parties will have to sit across and reconcile the ledger, because what one party is doing, the other party might not be aware. So they will have to actually reconcile. Otherwise, also required to reconcile. But now all the more for this, they'll have to reconcile their balances. Now, again, the accounts team will have to be thoroughly equipped with the knowledge of the provisions, because that's going to be an additional burden on them to, it's going to be an additional exercise for them to execute all this. Yes, software has to be changed, because a lot of automation, if brought in such kind of transactions, will reduce the work to a great extent. Definitely, there'll be interference of the human required to compute, interpret, and all, but software will reduce the work to a great extent. So both the entities, buyer and seller, will have to undergo a change in their accounting software. I think it's time we educate our clients that such a kind of provision is there, and it's time that they try and reconcile with their software guys as to how this can be implemented best. Additional check of PAN and non-filing. So this is going to add on to my compliance burden, where I'll have to sit and check whether these two provisions are also triggered or not. And only then can I be able to determine as to what should be the rate or what shall be the rate of reduction. Let us take a quick example in all these scenarios just to be a little clear as to which provision will apply when. So first is the column where there's the turnover of buyer, second is for the seller, and third is the transaction of purchases or sale of goods, as the case may be. So limits, we are aware, buyer 10 crore, seller 10 crore, and transaction 50 lakhs. In case of first scenario, buyer's limit is exceeding, seller's limit is not exceeding. Now, these are all scenarios after 1st July 2021, because both the sections become applicable. In that case, the liability will be on the buyer, 194 crore. Second scenario, buyer's limit is not exceeding, seller's limit is exceeding, transaction limit is exceeding. So seller will be liable, simple. Third scenario, both the turnover for both is not exceeding. However, the purchase threshold is exceeding, purchase sale transaction threshold. Still, it will not be applicable because none of the people are, buyer or seller, are required to deduct any TDS. Fourth scenario could be where both the parties are above the threshold limit of 10 crores, but the purchase or sale transaction is below the threshold limit of 50 lakhs. Then again, the section, none of the sections are applicable. In the third scenario, in the fifth scenario, both the parties are beyond the threshold limit. The purchase or sale transaction is also beyond the threshold limit. In that case, both the sections are applicable, but priority will be for buyer under 194Q. In this scenario, if the buyer is liable, yes, but he does not deduct TDS, then the seller has to collect TCS under this section. So buyer will be penalized for his he will have to face the consequences, but even the seller is made to do this transaction in case the buyer does not do it. So this was an example in the various scenarios possible. Now, let us look at when they are saying 50 lakhs of value or aggregating value of goods, then what does goods mean? It's not defined under 194Q. Sorry, there's an error. 194Q has not been mentioned. 194 has been mentioned. There is no definition under 206C1H. Neither section 2 defines. So where do we look? There are various acts, Constitution of India, which define what a good could be. So two definitions I have given down. One is as per Sales of Goods Act 1930. Another is in the GST provision. So goods under Sales of Goods Act is goods means every kind of movable property other than actionable claims and money, and includes stock, shares, etc., etc., etc. Similarly, in GST, the definition is goods means every kind of movable property other than money and security, but includes actionable claim. So a little different in the section. So which one to apply? So because we are dealing with a transaction which is sale of goods, it makes or it appears that a Sale of Goods Act definition should be adopted because it's a direct correlation with the transaction that we are looking into. So when you say if Sales of Goods Act is applicable for the definition of goods, or you take or you borrow the definition from there, then it could be every kind of kind of movable property, and this also includes stock, shares, and all. So movable property, commodities, I've given a few examples: share, securities, electricity, agriculture produce. We'll discuss a few in the next slides to come, like motor vehicle, jewelry, bullion, and all. So now let us see whether all these heads of goods, whether there'll be a trigger or not. One is services. Now, time and again, at various sections under the law, the department has tried to, or the law has tried to distinguish between goods and services. And ideally in that scenario, services shouldn't be considered for this 194Q or 206C1H. So ideally it should be only goods. Then shares and securities. Now, we saw in the definition that any movable property, including shares and securities, under the Sales of Goods Act 1930. So by virtue of that, shares and securities is a good, and then the section becomes applicable. But there is an exemption given to shares and securities, which are listed shares and securities, under a CBDT circular number 17, 2020, I think dated 29 September 2020, where it is trying to say that if share transactions are made on a recognized stock exchange, then it will not apply because the transactions happen through our platform and the buyer doesn't know who the seller is and the seller doesn't know who the buyer is. So in that scenario, 206C1H will not apply. 194Q, no clarification till now, but the government ideally on the same logic should get it for 194Q as well. So similar exemption should be there. This we spoke about listed securities. How about unlisted shares? That there is no mention in the section because here very well the buyer and the seller are identifiable. So going with the definition, listed shares crossing that threshold limit will definitely be liable to TDS or TCS as the case may be. So when there are share transactions, it is people have to be very sure when they are doing such transfer of share whether this trigger happens or not, and accordingly TDS or TCS is deducted or collected. Immovable property, it's not a movable property, so going by definition it will not come. Also 194I, there's a specific section which applies TDS on immovable property, so in the case of a builder stock and trade. So this section 194Q shouldn't get triggered in immovable property. Electricity, now electricity per se is not seen or visible, it is an intangible item. So whether it is a good or not, so there is some decision in case of National Thermal Power which has been, where it has been held that electricity, even though it is intangible, it has the capability, or it has the, it has three characteristics. One is it is utility based, second thing it can be bought and sold, and third thing was it is it can be transmitted or transferable or possessed by someone. So the said judgment speaks of these three characteristics for a good, and electricity very well satisfies the three conditions, and hence it is considered as good. So yes, it is applicable, but again there is an exemption under CBT circular 17/2020 which says that if electricity, renewable energy certificates and energy savings are traded through power exchanges, then this provision will not apply. Similarly, 194Q should also not apply in this case. Obviously, we wait for the clarification, but same analogy can be drawn. Capital goods, whether there'll be trigger or not. So if you read the section, again, goods is not defined, and it is not saying whether it is to be used for the purpose of business, whether it is for investment, whether it is a fixed asset. No such definition or no such reference has been made under the section. So going by the plain reading, any good, it could be tangible, intangible, stock in trade or capital goods, everything gets covered. So even if it's a capital good, the transaction is very well within the purview of 194Q and 206C1H. Next is jewelry. Jewelry, definitely yes, because movable property. So this will be included. Then motor car, I have a separate slide for that, so I'll cover it in the next slide to come. We can go on software. Software, the very much litigated in various laws, even in income tax, even when we had VAT or service tax, the VAT guys would always say that software is like a good, and hence VAT should be levied. Similar was the view when service tax guys came in, they said, okay, no, it's a kind of a service, and then service tax should be levied. So there has always been some of the litigation. Obviously, in GST now it has got restricted because it applies to both. So as it is covered. But same was the position even in case of income tax, where software is litigated to understand whether it's a purchase of goods or services. Now, a reference can be, so there are various judgments both to and fro. A reference can be made to the judgment of TCS in the case of sales tax. This judgment was rendered in the case of sales tax, where it has been said that canned software or off-the-shelf software should be considered as goods. Now, what are canned software? Are pre-written program modules or something which is available on the shelf for purchase at a retail outlet. Say the best example could be a Tally software that we use. So Tally software is a software which can be sold to a lot many people because it's not customized. So one view could be that something which is otherwise available and not customized could be a software which will be in the nature of purchase of goods, it's still not too clear on this, because which if we say something like this, it means that customized softwares could be in the purview of purchase of services. But if you look at customized softwares, even they are like a product which is being made specifically for someone and sold to them. So how do you distinguish? So one thing could be where in all these kind of off-the-shelf software, I don't have a right to such kind of software. So maybe somewhere where right is getting transferred to me, but again, that is not final. So this is going to be a gray area. Every contract of software purchase will have to be seen separately to understand what is the real substance, whether it is in the nature of purchase of goods or whether it is in the nature of purchase of services. And accordingly, if it qualifies to be good, 194Q comes in. If not, then it's out of the problem. Now, I just spoke about motor car. Okay. Motor car has three sections involved. So we'll go a little slow on this one. Okay. There is 206C1F, which is sale, the collection of TCS on sale of a motor vehicle. 206C1H, which is sale of goods on receipt of above the threshold limit, and 194Q, purchase of goods above the threshold limit. Now, in case of a motor car, how do you see it? First, let's understand what the transaction is all about. I'll explain what transaction are we looking at. There's a manufacturer who will build a motor car. He will sell it to a distributor. Distributor will ultimately sell it to a retailer, and retailer will finally give it to a consumer who's going to buy that car. Okay, so four people involved. Every person is a buyer or seller for the other person. So manufacturer is a seller for distributor. Distributor is a buyer for manufacturer, but a seller to the retailer. Similarly, retailer is a buyer to the distributor and seller to the consumer. And consumer is ultimately someone who will consume the product. Now, 206C1F is clearly and specifically on motor cars, but there is a CBDT circular 22 of 2016, which says that the intention was to capture retail sales only, and hence this section should not apply to manufacturer or distributor. Okay, so manufacturer or dealers. So in our case, 206C will not apply to manufacturer or distributor. Now let us see why I'm saying 206 needs to be applied first is because both sections 194Q and 206C1H says that if TCS is deducted under any other section, then that should be on prioritized. So we will first test if 206C1F is applicable or not. After that, I will test 194Q because that is overriding or above 206C1H. And if nothing applies, then 206C1H will apply. So we checked 206C1F for two sellers, manufacturer and distributor, in their capacity of seller. Now, in case of a retailer being a seller, we need to test whether 206C1F is applicable or not. So 206C1F is triggered when there is a sale of motor vehicle beyond 10 lakh rupees. Now, there could be two scenarios possible here. Car sale is the sale of one car is beyond 10 lakhs, and overall sale to that customer could be more than 50 lakhs. So maybe a car which is worth 1 crore of rupees, it satisfies both car sale of more than 10 lakhs and overall sales a threshold of 50 lakhs. There is second scenario where car sale is less than 10 lakhs, but the same customer comes and buys from me multiple cars, all aggregating to more than 50 lakhs. Okay. So in the first scenario, because 10 lakhs is already triggered, then in that case, 206C1F will definitely apply, because the section also says, and the circular also says, that retail sale is the intention, and hence in the first scenario, 206C1F applies. We need not check for 194Q or 206C1H. Now we go to 194Q. For the time being, let's keep this the second scenario of car sale with the consumer aside. Let us test 194Q. 194Q comes in play when buyer is involved. So I have two buyers right now. In fact, three buyers. One is consumer, one is retailer, and one is distributor. So distributor is a buyer from manufacturer. In his case, 194Q will definitely apply. And this is in a scenario where all the thresholds are satisfied. Okay, so then distributor will be required to do 194Q in case of a manufacturer. Next is retailer. He is a buyer for distributor, so he will also be required to do 194Q when he is doing a purchase from the distributor. So that is satisfied. Now, a consumer, whether he will be liable to 194Q. So generally, consumers are not, assuming consumers are not people. So consumer can be of two types, one who has a threshold limit and one who does not have. But in both the scenarios, it will not apply. The reason being, when the threshold is satisfied, 206C1F is already applied by the retailer between the transaction between retailer and consumer. So 194Q says that if TCS under any other section is already deducted, then as a buyer, I'm not required to. So consumer will not when the threshold crosses. And when the threshold does not cross, as it is, he is not required to under 194Q. So the consumer will never be under any scenario to deduct or collect TCS. Deduct TCS. Now, so we saw 206C1F, we saw 194Q. Now let us try and test 206C1H. We earlier discussed that 206C1H section says that if there is a good which is on which the TCS is already getting collected under 1F, then this section should not apply to me. So per se, it shouldn't apply to me. But if you read the wording or the clarification given by the CBDT under Circular 17 of 2020, there they have tried to clarify that 1F and 1H are two different scenarios. 1F is trying to capture retail sales where only a motor vehicle has been sold at a retail level. But 1H is a much wider section, and it is trying to cover those kind of entities who cross the threshold limit. So it's much more beyond than 194, much more beyond than 206C1F. Hence, 206C1H will definitely apply to manufacturers and retailers. So even though section says that it does not apply to goods mentioned in 1F, but the clarification and the intention has been brought by the CBDT in Circular 17-2020. So we will have to test 206C1H also in the scenarios where distributor is a seller and manufacturer is a seller. So manufacturer 206C1H will not apply because the buyer, distributor, has already done 194Q. Suppose there was a scenario where the distributor was not crossing the threshold mentioned 194Q, then in that case, the manufacturer as a seller would have to collect TCS on 206C1H. We go to the second leg of transaction where distributor is the seller and retailer is the buyer. Again, in the same in the scenario that we discussed earlier, he otherwise is liable to, but will not deduct because 194Q has been done by the buyer. So if the buyer does not cross the threshold limit, the retailer being the buyer not crossing the threshold limit, or crossing the threshold limit, liable to but has not deducted, then in that case, distributor will be liable to collect TCS under 206C1H. So this was all about the three provisions applying in the case of a motor car sell right from manufacturer to the ultimate consumer. So very thoroughly, this needs to be applied in case you have clients falling in any of the scenarios. The three sections need to be reviewed thoroughly and checked whether what becomes applicable to be very clear. Otherwise, the consequence will have to be faced on this. So this was in the case of motor car. Now, other considerations under 194Q and 206C1H, claim of credit of TCS, TDS. So when will I be eligible to claim this? So Rule 37BA, as it applies to all the TDS sections under Chapter 17B, it applies to 194Q as well, which says that TDS will be claimed in the year in which income is offered. So matching concept will have to be done. But the same is not the scenario in case of 206C1H. Here, the Rule 37I will apply, which tries to say that TCS, the credit of TCS to the buyer, when deducted, when collected by the seller, will be given in the year in which the same is collected by the seller. So say for example, a situation where advance has been given by the purchaser to the seller for purchase of goods. Now that transaction has happened at the cutoff of March, year end maybe. the actual transaction of purchase or sale happens in the next year. Now, either 194Q will apply, but if that does not apply, and if the seller has collected TCS under 206C1H on the advances, because the seller is bound to by virtue of receipt of money, then in that case, the buyer will be eligible to claim TCS in the year of collection, that is the first year itself, because it does not require the matching concept. So TCS, no matching concept, TDS, yes. Now, in case of transition provisions, what will be the scenario when the purchases prior to 1st July are made with a particular party, whether the 50 lakh threshold limit needs to be checked for any transaction with him post 1st July. So again, no clarification yet of board circular awaited, but a similar scenario was already explained in CBDT circular 17-2020, which says that if I have sold, so in case of TCS, if I have sold goods to a particular party prior to 1st October, because that was the date when it became applicable, then in that scenario, yes, the first sales will definitely be considered for computing the 50 lakh threshold limit. So same analogy has to apply for 194Q as well. Then, okay. So purchases are exceeding 50 lakhs prior to 1st July, but receipt is made to the seller post 1st July. Then in that scenario, whether 194Q will come in play or 206C1H. So 194Q section says payment or credit, whichever is earlier. Now in this case, the credit has happened first prior to 1st July. So 194Q will not apply, and hence receipt is later. So even though receipt is after 1st July, buyer will not be liable to 194Q because one of the two events has already happened prior to 1st July. So the seller will be bound to collect TCS under 206C1H. Okay. Next is whether GST on purchases and sales, whether TCS or TDS collection or TCS collection, TDS deduction or TCS collection has to be made on the GST amount or not. So we are very well aware that earlier we had a circular on service tax where it was clarified, it was circular, I don't have the circular number for service tax, but it was clarified that there will be no TDS on service tax collected on services rendered. And post service tax and in the new regime of GST, by circular 23-2017, it was clarified that similarly, if GST is levied on services, TDS on the GST component will not be deducted on not be deducted on GST component. Now, if you note, this circular is with reference to GST on services. It does not speak anything about GST on goods, because that was never a scenario. So whether GST on sale of goods, whether TCS or TDS will be deductible or collectible, there is a circular again 17-2020 which clarifies that no adjustment for GST has to be made when you are collecting TCS on sale of goods, which means that even if GST is a part part and component of the sales amount, then TCS will be collected on that as well. And similarly, applying, since we are, the provisions are similar, 194Q, in the law of 194Q as well, GST on TDS, TDS on GST will, GST component will apply. So as of now, nothing has been clarified, but this circular states that yes, 206C1H and 194Q, GST component with TDS and TCS will be there. Next scenario would be, okay, so when I am making an advance payment to the seller before and after July, so let us first analyze what will be the position before 1st of July 2021. In that scenario, I think we discussed this, so I think we can skip this one. We already said that there's a receipt and hence 206C1H will apply. The second scenario is this we discussed, that post July, if the transaction of advances happened, then whether TDS liability of 194Q is there or not. So One view is yes, credit or payment, whichever is earlier. If my payment is earlier, then it will be applicable as per the provisions of the section. But there could also be one view that, you know, section 4, which states that the chargeability section, which says that TDS should be deductible only on income which is chargeable to tax. So when I am giving an advance to a seller, whether it is his income, because my transaction has still not got freezed. So whether any advances, whether I can take a stand that TDS liability is not liable to be deducted. In that case, then seller's 206C1H will come in here. So this is one view possible. A conservative view would be to deduct TDS. The second one, the other one is branch transfers, whether TDS is applicable on branch transfers or not. So the section per se has a requirement of having a purchaser and a seller. In case of branch transfer, it is the same entity, one bank but different branches, so it should not apply. What if a seller has multiple units? Then in that case, if that multiple units come under one bank, then transaction has to be aggregated to determine the TDS TCS liability. If the multiple units are under different PAN, then accordingly the threshold limit have to be calculated for each and every PAN as such. Then what about barter transactions? So a transaction where amount is paid or received other than cash, maybe in kind, whether these kind of transactions get covered. So 206C1H uses the word receipt of sale consideration. So in my view, I think that kind of transactions in kind, if you go by the intention of law, yes, it is trying to capture such kind of transactions where government is aware and knows and there'll be TDS and TCS. But going by the literal wordings of the section, it uses the word receipt of sale consideration. So receipt could be in terms of money, and hence barter transactions should not be covered. When we come to 194Q, in that case, the words used are any sum paid. Just give me a minute. It says any sum, paying any sum to any resident by any sum paid to any resident by any mode. So here initially it is using the word any sum, which represents money or amount, but then it is using the words payment by any mode. So two views possible here as well, but the only concern is when the consideration is paid or received in kind, then how will you be able to compute the value to deduct TDS? So this is a practical issue, needs to be seen what is the department view on this. Then sales turnover or gross receipts, whether while computing the 10 crore threshold limit, GST should be considered or not. So again, not defined anywhere in the section. We can draw a reference to 44AB, which has similar wording, and there it is trying to say that if the accounting of the seller or buyer, as the case may be, is where they don't take a credit and GST is included in the sales amount, then the computation, then the threshold limit will include GST. If he is taking a credit and he is not grossing up his sales or purchases, then the computation of threshold should be without GST. What in case of purchase or sale of goods, whether the same logic will apply in case of GST? I think we should not be including GST when we are determining the 50 lakh limit for purchase or sales, because in 194Q, the words used are value, purchase of any goods of the value or aggregate of such value. So here it is trying to use the words value, which is of importance. So if I look at the accounting standards and all, they try to say that if I have incurred any cost to bring any stock into existence, then I should add those costs to my stock. But here the wordings used are value. So I think GST should not be considered while computing the 50 lakh limit. My view, there could be another view as well. Next is ad hoc amount. Okay, so here what will happen is it's a normal tendency where the transactions when set off by payments are not in, so say for example, I am a seller who has sold or done 10 transactions with a buyer. Now I might have different bill amounts. Now not necessary that the buyer might give me one-to-one payments. So, assuming in that case the buyer is not liable to 194Q, then in that case the seller might have to gross up GST and TCS both. It's not TDS, it is TCS both, to determine the value of the transaction and then accordingly pay TCS. So this is going to be a little cumbersome for the accounts team to do this. So here we are done with the provisions of Finance Act 2021. The important ones I have picked up. So now we go with the similar amendments or other amendments in the Finance Act 2020. TDS on e-commerce transaction. Give me a minute. Yeah. So TCS, I'm so sorry. TCS on 1 minute. I just want Yeah, sorry. It's TDS on e-commerce transactions. So these days the transactions are now mostly happening on a lot of e-commerce platforms. So in order to capture those kind of transactions, the government has come out with this law in Finance Act 2020, where my transaction would be sale of goods or services on an e-commerce platform. So here it needs to be noted that both goods and services both are covered here. Now, how do these transactions happen? So there is an ultimate consumer, there is an e-commerce participant, and there is an e-commerce operator. So the consumer will order goods on the platform that is provided by the e-commerce operator. Best example could be Amazon, Flipkart, Swiggy. And an e-commerce participant is a person who is putting up his goods on these kind of platforms. So it could be a brand like Vero or W or someone like that, who are putting up their stuff on the platform or on the website or on the electronic digital facility of the Amazon or Flipkart. So here when the transaction which will get captured is the sale of goods or so ultimate purchase by the customer from the platform of Amazon or Swiggy. This is the transaction which is subject to TDS. Now, who is an e-commerce operator is, like we discussed, a person who owns, operates, manages a digital electronic facility or platform for e-commerce transaction. He could be a resident as well as non-resident. There is no restriction. So an entity who is operating a platform outside India will also get covered under this provision. Then TDS will be deducted in whose case? So say, for example, a brand called Vero Moda, who is giving his products to Amazon to sell, TDS will be deducted in his case. So e-commerce participant, but here the condition is that the e-commerce participant has to be resident in India. So a person or a brand which is outside India, who is putting on Amazon, TDS will not apply to such transactions or such on such people who are non-resident. So the e-commerce participant has to be resident in India who is selling goods or providing for services on the e-commerce platform. Now, when will this not apply? So assuming that the e-commerce participant is an individual and HUF, if his transactions in a particular financial year do not exceed the 5 lakh limit, and if he has furnished PAN and Aadhaar to Amazon, I'm just taking Amazon as an example to make it more clear. So then in that case, Amazon will not be liable to deduct TDS in the case of this particular person. Now, there is no threshold limit unlike the other sections. So even a 100 rupee transaction will be liable to TDS, subject to the limit specified for individual and HUF, definitely. But all the other entities, there is no limit. Now, rate of TDS will be 1% on sale or service or both, and the deduction will be the time of deduction will be credit or payment, whichever is earlier. The said section has been made applicable from 1st October 2020. And here there is one provision which says that in a transaction where, so generally transactions are where I make a payment, I as a customer will make payment to Amazon, and Amazon will then ultimately make a payment to the brand. Now, there could be a possibility or a mechanism where I make a payment directly, which goes to the brand, and Amazon is just an aggregator or a platform who provides me with such kind of platform for marketing my goods. So in that case, the section is trying to say that if there is a direct payment from the consumer to the brand, in that case also Amazon will be required to deduct TDS on such kind of sale or services. This is the section. Let us look at the example just for a little more clarity. So what we discussed right now, let's take a plain vanilla case where I as a customer is purchasing 1 lakh worth of goods. So 1% of the amount of goods Amazon will be required to deduct TDS. So 1,000 is the TDS that Amazon will deduct. Definitely when Amazon is giving me this platform, he will charge me a commission. So 100 rupees is the commission to be charged. So ultimately, what will be the amount that will be remitted by Amazon to the brand? So it's going to be 1 lakh minus 1,000 minus 100. He will try to pay 1,000 to the government and 100 he will recover for his fee. So 98,900 will be the 98,900 will be the amount that will be remitted by Amazon to XYZ. Now, the scenario that we just discussed, that, you know, what if there's a direct payment? So similar transaction purchased by me from the brand and I make a payment directly to the brand. So I have made 1 lakh worth of purchases and I have paid it to the brand XYZ. Now, Amazon will definitely recover his commission. He will also have to deduct TDS because he's bound to. So what will happen is now there is no remittance amount from which he can deduct. So Amazon will have to now raise a debit note of his TDS deduction as well as the 100 rupees of commission that he's going to charge. So 1100 will be the debit note, right, that he will raise. Now, some considerations here. Payment gateways. So when I am doing a transaction on Amazon, now either, so in case of Amazon, they have maybe have their own payment gateway, but what if they have other payment gateway like Paytm or PayU or something? So these kind of payment gateways equally qualify as an aggregator or an e-commerce operator as defined in the section, because they are giving services of enabling or collecting money on behalf of that brand. So when I'm doing a transaction on Amazon for that purchase from that brand, what will happen is there are two e-commerce operators that are involved. One, Amazon himself, and other one, say, Paytm. Now, what will happen is both being eligible under this section will be required to deduct TDS. And there'll be double deduction on the same transaction. So to avoid this kind of a scenario, CBDT by way of circular has given an exemption to payment gateways. In a scenario where if the e-commerce operator has deducted TDS on the same transaction, so the payment gateway will have to take some kind of declaration. To avoid a scenario of double deduction of tax, the payment gateways have been exempted, provided they take a declaration from the e-commerce operator that since you have deducted, I will not be able to deduct. Then there, in the same circular, so insurance agent or insurance aggregators are the people who provide a platform and are the mediator between an insurance company and the ultimate consumer. And what they earn is the agent services or the commission commission from the said policies and all. So in order to avoid that undue hardship on such kind of people, they have specifically exempted insurance agent or an aggregator who qualifies as an e-commerce operator, but they are not liable to deduct any TDS under 194(o). Then transactions prior to 1st October 2020. So again, threshold limit. So whenever there is a section which becomes applicable in between the year, then our transition provisions are always there. So again, a clarification here, similar to what we saw in 2061H, that if the transaction is prior to 1st October 2020, to determine that threshold limit of 5 lakh for individual HUF, that will definitely be considered. Then next is same thing that we discussed for GST in case of 2060 1H and 194Q. I'm not explaining the whole thing again, but on the GST part, definitely GST on services maybe is exempt by virtue of this circular, but on goods it's not exempt. So TDS will have to be taken on sale of goods. So this we already discussed, that when there's a payment directly from the consumer to the brand, then what could be the issues? So debit note will have to be raised. There could be cash flow issues because the buyer has already received, the brand has already received the full amount. Now when Amazon is trying to deduct that TDS, it's an additional thing which he'll have to reimburse. So till the time there's a reimbursement from the brand to Amazon, Amazon will have to pull out that amount from his pocket and make a payment to the government. What if the participant or the brand does not reimburse? Again, that's a hit, and that cost will have to be borne by the e-commerce operator. Again, like we discussed in 194, reconciliation is a must. There'll be an additional burden on the accounts team of both the brand and the e-commerce operator to reconcile their ledgers at a very regular intervals. Now, 194, this provision seems to be inconsistent with 198. Now, 198 is a section which says that TDS deducted in case of a person will be deemed to be his income. So in a scenario where all full amount has been paid by the consumer to the brand, the whole income has been received by the brand. Now, the e-commerce operator will separately raise a debit note of TDS. So TDS will be in addition to the amount fully received. So it will be like a double income in the hands of the e-commerce participant. So to that extent, it is inconsistent with the provision of 198. It shouldn't have implications per se, or shouldn't be triggered in the case of any of the e-commerce participants. So one hardship to the farmers, like we discussed before, that farmers have agricultural income by selling agricultural produce, and that is not liable to per se clarification, or no exclusion has been given in case of the farmer. So a farmer coming on an operator's platform and selling goods, the TDS will have to be deducted, and the farmer will be bound to file a return of income to claim that refund. One more provision in this section under 194.03 is that I'll explain the example directly. If there is a chartered accountant who is coming on the platform of Amazon, and if I as a customer want to avail his audit services, I will try and appoint him through that platform. Now in that case, what will happen is, first scenario covers a situation where his limit of 5 crores exceeds. So I pay 1 lakh to Amazon. Then Amazon will be required to deduct TDS at 1% because provision of services are covered. But I, as a customer who is availing audit services from the particular chartered accountant, I am not liable to 194 share, because the section very clearly says that if 194 is already triggered, then no other TDS section shall apply. So I, a person who is availing the services of CA, will not be liable to deduct TDS under 194J. Now, this was a scenario where the amounts exceeded 5 lakhs, but what in case he is an individual who is does not cross the threshold limit of rupees 5 lakhs? In that case, too, even if Amazon is not deducting 194O TDS, I will still not be required to do 194J. So here it's a win-win situation for the other chartered accountant who's providing services, because he's not crossing that limit. And this has been given in the provisions of 194.03. Yeah. this scenario we have already discussed. No, this we have not. Sorry, this is a different scenario where we are trying to say that, say, here in the example, I've tried to explain that I am a person who is availing the services of a technician from the e-commerce platform of Amazon. Now the technician comes at my home and does some repairing TV service or whatever. So in that case, per se, I have booked that services of a technician at the amount given on the e-commerce platform. Say I might have to incur something more when he comes here because he realizes that some spare parts or some services will require extra charges. So in that case, the technician is eligible for an income of 1 lakh, which was already obtained from Amazon's platform, and 20,000, which was additionally then required. So he is earning an income of 120. But Amazon is not aware about this 20,000 transaction happening between me as a customer and the technician. So Amazon is aware of only 1 lakh and his liability otherwise to deduct is 1200, being 1% of 1 lakh 20. But because he is not aware of the transaction, he will deduct only 1000. So to the extent of 200 of TDS, he has not complied. Now, how will they track such kind of a situation is not known. So if for whatever reasons the government is becomes aware of such kind of a scenario, then there is a non-compliance made by the e-commerce operator. So here we end with 194O. The next provision on the next TDS provision is TDS. Sorry, we now come on TCS. The next is TCS to be collected on foreign remittance under liberalized remittance scheme and on overseas tour package. Now, liberalized remittance scheme is every individual is allowed to make a remittance out of India for various purposes in a financial year to the extent of $250,000. That is the limit that is allowed to every individual to make a remittance outside India. Now, this remittance is always done through an AD, between the RBI and the ultimate consumer. It's the authorized dealer whom we deal with when foreign exchange is in question. So whenever there is any foreign remittance made under this LRS scheme, under this section, the authorized dealer will be the person who will be liable to deduct TDS. He will be liable to collect TCS from the remitter. And the threshold limit given here is 7 lakh of rupees. So if anything is remitted in excess of 7 lakhs, then that will be subject to TCS by the AD. Now, the rate is 5% on the amount of remittance. And if this remittance is for pursuing education and the remittance comes by way of loan from financial institution, then the rate has been reduced from 5% to 0.5%. The time of collection will be at the time of debit or payment, whichever is earlier. Because he's collecting, it will be debit or payment, whichever is earlier. This section became applicable from 1st October 2020. And similarly, under the same provision, when a seller is selling overseas tour program package. Now, overseas tour program package has been defined. So the overseas tour package has been defined to mean a tour package which offers a visit to a country or countries or territories outside India and includes expense for travel, hotel stay, boarding, lodging, or any other expenditure similar to in the nature of traveling outside India. So if a seller who is selling such kind of a product, then he will also be required to collect TCS at the rate of 5% on the amount of remittance. Now, there is a provision which says if the seller has already collected TCS, then the AD will not have to separately collect TCS on the same transaction. So if the AD is making remittance on behalf of a customer, then to the overseas tour package manager or something, then TCS will not be triggered again because that transaction has already suffered TCS by the seller. Again, time limit, point of collection is the same and applicability is the same. Here also, they have given exemptions that if TDS has been, any such kind of payments which are liable to TDS under any other section and TDS has been deducted there, then TCS will not come into play. and remittance by these few entities are exempted from the provision of TCS. Yeah, so what could be the transactions that could be covered under the LRS scheme? So it could be travel, just a normal travel or a vacation that we do outside India, or maybe a gift or a donation made, someone who is going for studies abroad. So that could be one of the transactions where remittance is made. Someone is doing a business trip. Someone is going for employment outside India. Someone is going for a medical treatment. These are all the current account transactions, and there could be capital account transactions like purchase of property or making investments outside India. So the list could be much more. I have just given an example of a few transactions which get covered. So be careful as to when you are under any of these transactions, and if the specified limit is crossed, then the AD, obviously it's the responsibility of the AD, but it will definitely attract TCS. Now, there could be, whenever a student is going for studies outside India, either he manages his funds or either his parents help him manage the funds. But in a lot many cases, such parents or students are already struggling to make arrangements for the payment of education outside India. In this scenario, when such a kind of provision comes in, where it is not by way of loan and they are shelling in the whole of the amount from their savings, then 5% is the TCS which they will have to additionally shell out. So in addition to what they are supposed to pay to the universities or for the stay and all, 5% on that amount will be the additional amount which the parent or the student will have to shell out. And this is a very true hardship faced by such kind of people. So nothing to that extent has been yet bought, or no relaxation has been got to the in the, such a kind of a scenario. Then threshold limit per AD. So here the 7 lakh limit applies per AD. And what if I have done a transaction with multiple ADs? Say generally the banks are the ADs. And if what if I have procured or made remittance with different banks? Then a tracking is not possible in such a case. So could be a possibility that I have crossed 7 lakh limit, but with multiple ADs. So a possibility that TCS might not get collected from me. Then again, the threshold limit, because it's a the transition provision of 1st October. Again, here there is no circular per se to determine the threshold limit of 7 lakh rupees. But applying the same analogy, the threshold limit of 7 lakhs should be considered for transactions done prior to 1st October 2020. So that was it for TCS on LRS and overseas tour package. We come to the next provision, which is a very welcome provision in case of deferment of TDS in case of ESOPs for startups. Now, as we are aware, startup is the new normal as on today. We can find a lot many startups coming up with new innovative ideas. Now, these startups generally have huge expenses to be incurred before establishing themselves in the market. So they have a real hard cash burnout in terms of marketing, getting customers, or maybe expanding business or something. So in such a scenario, what happens is, if I have to, as a startup, employ some talented person, I might not be able to do it because my cash burnout is already too high. What do I do in such a scenario is, I offer that employee some portion as salary in cash, and the other portion I tell him that, okay, I will give you ESOPs of my company. That is how it has been practically being done in all the startups. Now, already there is a cash burnout. So in case of an ESOP, what happens is, there are four levels or four events. One is the grant of the options, second is vesting of options, third is exercise of options, and fourth is the allotment. So in ESOPs, what happens is, so ESOP concept is per se giving away of shares of my company at a discounted rate, or a lower rate than the usual rate, or maybe the face value. So here, this ESOP is treated as perquisites in the hand of employee. So perquisite is a kind of salary, but in kind, not in cash. Now, at that time, the trigger of TDS in case of ESOPs come in when the employee exercises this option. So in that case, the company is supposed to make payment for TDS between the difference of the price value on the date or the fair value on the date of exercising of the ESOP and the price at which I have allotted ESOPs. So that differential will be subject to TDS under 192. Now TDS cannot be, in case of perquisites, might not be recovered from the salary. So it becomes as an additional hit to the startup who's already on a very high cash burnout. So what the amendment is a very welcome amendment, and what the government has truly considered it to defer such kind of TDS on startups. But for a startup to avail this, he has to be an eligible startup as defined under ATIAC, which is a company or an LLP engaged in eligible business. Eligible business has been defined, I don't have the definition right now, but has been defined to be a business with innovation and development. This business has to be commenced from 1st April 16 to 1st April, between 1st April 16 and the last date for commencement is 1st April 2022. 2021 was the date which got amended to another 1 year for the ATIC deduction. Then the turnover should be less than 25 crores in the year of claim of deduction. So ATIC, whenever I'm claiming a deduction, my turnover shouldn't cross this. And I should, as an eligible startup, hold certificate from the Inter-Ministerial Board of Certification. So there's a process where I explain my business and a certificate is issued to me. On fulfillment of these conditions, I'll be an eligible startup. And only an eligible startup is allowed to defer his TDS liability on ESOPs. Now, what will be the deferment? The deferment is 14 days from the earliest of the three. So if say 48 months have passed by from the date of, from the end of the relevant assessment year from in which the ESOP was exercised. That is one of the criteria. Second is either if the employee has already sold that ESOP shares prior to 48 months coming into play, or the employee ceases to be an employee with me as a startup. So if any of the earlier of the three situations, 14 days from that earlier situation, the company, that is the startup, will be liable to pay TDS on ESOPs. Now this is applicable from 1st April 2021. And one provision of 191 has been amended to give effect to this. It says that where the employer has failed to deduct TCS or deducts but fails to pay the same, then the employee shall be liable to make the payment directly. So the employee, so if he comes to know that the employer has not deducted TDS on this perquisite amount, then he'll have to consider that in his return of income and pay tax. Nevertheless, the employer, so if both of them default, then there'll be an assessee in default and the consequences will follow accordingly. So it's a very good provision and reducing the hardship faced by the startups. Next is reduction in the rate of fees for technical services. The whole intention, so this is under 194J, which was amended. The rate has been reduced for technical services from 10% to 2% in Finance Act 2020. Now, the whole intention was there was a lot of litigation for short deduction where for a particular services, the assessee considered it to be getting covered under 194C, which has a rate of 2% and 1%, whereas the assessing officer tried to cover it under technical services for 10%. So in order to reduce that number of litigations, the government has proposed and made an amendment that technical services, any payment in the nature of technical services will be liable to TDS at 2% in place of 10%. Now, though the intention of the government was very good to reduce litigation, but distinguishing technical services from professional fees itself is a challenge. And this is now going to give us new set of litigation and new set of arguments by both the assessee and the assessing officer. Time and again, we'll say, already this is very controversial in a lot of other sections, but time and again, we'll get to know what is the stand. It's very difficult to determine what could be technical services apart from professional services. So professional services are a wider term. Technical services could be a part of this. Professional services are generally skill, intellectual and manual skill and expertise that gained by a particular person by doing some education or taking some knowledge or something, and they have defined profession to be someone who's into the field of legal could be lawyer, medical for doctors, accounting, chartered accountant or cost accountant, engineers, architects, interior decorators. Now these are the professionals. How do you separate them from technical? So for technical services, they have given a reference to definition referred to in 917, I suppose. I think I've written 918 to 917, which means consideration for rendering any managerial, technical or consultancy services, but does not include consideration for construction, assembly, mining or light project undertaken, or consideration that would have been chargeable under salary. So what could be managerial, technical or consultancy, and how do you distinguish it? Managerial could be something where I have to handle the management and daily affairs of a company. Say it could be maybe controlling the affairs or directing or managing or maybe administrating the people. That could be something which we associate with managerial. Technical could be something where I require that technical skill to give away that services. And consultancy could be where I play or give advisory role, or someone who comes and consults me for a particular project. So I give my specialized advisory on that. So how do you distinguish is going to be another tricky task to determine how can a technical service be separated from a professional services. Not necessary that people who are professionals, like we just saw, could not get covered under technical. So here I've given an example where I am taking the service of an engineer. An engineer is very well qualified under the 44AA list of professionals. But if there are two types of services which I take from an engineer one and engineer two. One person gives me testing and certification, and there is another one who gives me AMC services. So testing and certification requires specialized skill. He'll have to apply his knowledge and education that he's taken and then certify something. So maybe service of an engineer in that case would fall under professional fees. But if an engineer, I have a tie-up with some computer services who come and do an AMC for all my computers in the offices every month, and if they send an engineer, in that case, even though he has that technical knowledge, but he's just carrying out the work per se. So maybe in that scenario, it could be classified to be a technical services. So every case will have to be seen on its own as to what can be qualified in what. Tricky situation, every situation will have to be analyzed for this. Now, this is where I end all my amendments. What could be the way forward here? I think the way TDS and TCS provisions are coming in, the way the amendments are being brought in, the way there is interrelation and correlation of various TCS, TDS sections, it's high time that both the management and the chartered accountant is to upgrade themselves. So if I look at the management side, it's time that we as chartered accountant should educate our client, make them aware. So what he should do is, in order to reduce his efforts, like we discussed, automation is the best thing. I think many big companies have already started working on this after the provisions came into play. 206CH1H, for that, people had already made many changes in the software last year. Now, given the provision of 194Q and also still some clarity from the board, the softwares will have to be redone. They'll have to be undone from the previous thing and redone. So to the extent possible, where volumes are high, automation will work. So automation has to be done ASAP. Then even though there is automation that is going to reduce your work, but because there are so many interpretational issues, you will always need human force to see and test every situation. So in that case, whoever is the team in that accounts team who's handling TDS matters or who's responsible to check every invoice, they have to be upgraded. They have to made aware that there are multiple scenarios where TDS. So every transaction that they come or faced with, they have to test whether TDS is not applicable or TCS is not applicable in any particular section. So knowledge upgradation is one thing that they need to be, it needs to be done. Then communication between the two teams of buyer and seller. Just we saw in the case of 194Q and 206H, when there's a purchaser and seller, and also in case of e-commerce, where there are multiple e-commerce operators, or there is a brand who's an e-commerce participant. the accounts team at both the ends will be required to really work hard and communicate, because if they don't communicate, it's going to be a mess, it's going to be a hassle. Ledger reconciliation is going to be, I mean, they'll have to really understand who is doing the liability, and if he's not doing, am I liable to, and if I have to, otherwise we both face consequences. So communication needs to be done big time every now and then. These guys will have to do ledger reconciliations at very regular intervals. Like, for example, in Monday before Q, TDS is supposed to be deducted by him for a particular month, because that is the time he's made the payment, advance or payment, whichever is earlier, but he doesn't do. So the seller is required to do it, do a TCS on receipt of that month. Now, if this ledger reconciliations does not happen, even if the purchaser does TDS, the seller also does, and they maybe one does and one does not, then the other is not aware that he has to, and such kind of issues are going to crop up. So, you know, regular intervals, so that I don't miss out on my date of depositing TDS and date of filing my returns, I'll have to do a regular reconciliations with the other party. Reconciliation of TDS and TCS, like we saw, there are TCS sections which are on receipt basis, and TDS is on credit or payment, whichever is earlier. So a lot of many reconciliations for claiming that credit in a financial year will have to be kept in mind, given all these provisions. Then there'll be various declarations to be procured. So so seller, say if the buyer is already deducting, then maybe the seller will be required to bring in declaration. Similar will be in the case of e-commerce operators, where we saw payment aggregator and the e-commerce Amazon. So such kind of declarations will have to be exchanged. So this is on the management side. But what about we as a chartered accountant? You know, we also have to upgrade ourselves big time. We need to have a thorough knowledge. It's not going to be an article, simply an article's job now. It will even, so definitely they are much more equipped with than we do. But as professionals, we also have to check whether what is applicable in what scenario. So TDS, TCS provisions before going on audit has to be thoroughly brushed up. For this, we can always have internal sessions for knowledge upgradation for our own selves, as well as for the articles in our offices. So that should be done. Audit workings and reconciliation. Clause 34 is already a big exercise that we do. And we always think that, okay, articles are there, they'll manage and all. But I don't think that should be the attitude that we should keep. It's too much of reporting in that, and our signing also goes in that. So it becomes very important to maintain a thorough RICO as to whether I have mentioned the amounts or taken the amounts correctly. Also, at the time of audit, if there is an opinion which the client has taken, or maybe there are decisions available by virtue of which he has not deducted, or there are declarations made by him, for our purpose, for our tax audit report purposes, we should document this thoroughly, because today we remember and we have checked everything, but 2 years down the line when there'll be a scrutiny, we'll not be in a position maybe to recollect what was the stand taken. So always try and document it when you close any of the tax audit reports as to what was the stand taken by you or by the management. So these are a few points which both of them should take care of. And last slide is maybe, I think it's time up, and it's just a provision or a slide on consequences as to if there's a non-deduction or non-payment, then what will happen. So a disallowance of 30%. Then he'll be treated as an assessee in default, recovery of tax and interest will be levied. Assessee in default we already discussed, so I'm not going into it again. Penalty would be in two sections, one for TDS, TCS, where it could be a penalty of an amount equal to the amount of TDS or TCS. And next could be prosecution. So this comes in play when I have deducted, but I have failed to pay it to the government. So there could be prosecution, which could be not less than 3 months till up to 7 years with fine. So these could be a few consequences. This should be kept in mind while determining liability. So that's it from my end. And thank you everyone for a patient hearing.
Thank you, Ethel, for guiding us through the amendments and issues of TDS and TCS under income tax. There are a few queries that have been posted directly to me, so I'll just quickly run through them. So yeah, if we have not covered that in your presentation, maybe you can just tell me. So as per section 190, TDS is to be deducted if the income is chargeable under section 4
Right.
How much constitutional is it to charge TDS on purchase of goods as there is no income element?
Isn't it an income of the other party, the seller? Because he is making sales already, right? So it is an income. Why do we say it is not an income?
Okay. When goods are purchased or sold without any delivery, whether TDS will be applicable? Example, speculation in any commodity.
So I go back to the circular which covered that if it's a security or a share which is traded on an exchange, then there is no buyer seller, and then there should not be any liability for TDS. So I understand a commodity without delivery on an exchange platform, they are exempted from virtue of TDS 194.
If the full payment is not received, maybe due to cash discount on what TDS, TCS should be applicable, whether invoice value or amount paid credit received is the value on which TDS, TCS should be made applicable.
So TCS says receipt of sale consideration.
Right.
And TDS uses the word value of the transaction. So I think it should be on the purchase value in case of 194Q. And in 206CH also, it should be the sale value without discount, because it uses the word receipt as consideration. So my consideration per se is the sale value only. Because he's making a payment early to me, I am doing a cash discount, which is not. So that is, and that is a kind of a discount I'm giving because of early payment, not because of my sales. So I think it should be on gross value.
Okay. TDS will be applicable on GST amount, but while calculating 50 lakhs, we don't have to consider GST. So instance where after adding GST amounts exceed 50 lakhs, so whether TDS, TCS provisions are applicable?
Like I said, my view that, you know, the words used are value for goods, and definitely value for goods does not include GST. It will be purely a purchase sale. So determining it for a threshold is separate from determining it from the applicability of TDS or TCS. So definitely if it's on services, no TDS, TCS on GST. If it's on goods, yes, definitely, because these are two separate things.
Okay. If there is subsequently sales return or purchase return, whether TDS amount is required to be revised?
How will you be able to do that also now? So if the two scenarios possible here, one, before doing your TDS or TCS payment to the government, you are aware that there is some sales return or purchase return, you'll be able to revise it. But if what if you've already deducted and return has already gone, then in that scenario, I think you'll not be able to revise, and there's no choice but the other party to claim it while filing return of income, and maybe maintain a RICO to that extent to explain his transaction.
Okay.
Hello. Can it be adjusted against the subsequent purchases? Goods return. I'm talking about a distributor who is buying from a particular company only all this time.
Right.
He has already purchased certain goods and he has a regular goods return.
So
now.
Yeah. So what I understand in that case is that if your time limit for TDS return or TCS return has not passed by, you can still make adjustments to the excess payment and the other invoice. But if it is, I think, possible for even revising your TDS TCS return, maybe that can be done. I'm not aware practically it is possible or not. But
no, Hital, I'm on the point that in a particular month I have purchased, I have paid the tax. On the subsequent month, I get to know about the goods return, and can that be adjusted against the subsequent month's purchases from the same company?
Okay, so you're saying whether that purchase return can be adjusted against the purchases of the next transaction?
Naturally, because my net purchases would be reduced to that extent, right?
Right, absolutely.
In my trading account, it will show like in reduced purchases. If I'm deducting more and more, it won't be reconciled again with my purchase account.
Yes, absolutely. In terms of accounting, definitely you will be able to see only the net amount, and I don't foresee a problem in that. I think that can very well be adjusted.
For 206AB, which 2 years to be considered?
One second. I'll just go back to the provision. So this section is applicable from 1st July 21, which is for transactions for financial year 21-22. So I think it should be applicable immediately for, I think I mentioned 19 and 20, but it should be 20 and 21. So I stand corrected there. It should be immediately years in from the year from in which it is to be deducted. So it should be March 21 and March 22.
Ma'am, Chetan here, whether this will be not be applicable till 31st July, right? Because the time has not gone, so the condition is not satisfied until 31st July or in the case as maybe 30th November.
Correct. So I had covered the scenario, just repeating it once again, could be a possibility that by the time I decide that other person has not filed his return and he still has that time, then maybe he'll have to come out or take a declaration from the other party that the other party will be filing the return. And based on that, I will go ahead with the normal rules.
No, my question is that this section will not trigger at all. Till 31st July, this section is not applicable to any person because the time limit has not passed.
Sorry, but 1st July is the section when
not 1st July, 31st July.
No, I'm saying 1st July is the date when this section
has got triggered. From 1st July.
Now, but you are saying that 31st July is the date when that's the last date for me to file the return.
Filing 2021, assessment of 21-22 return.
Correct.
That has not gone. So this section will not get triggered at all.
No, but so if I see this way, it is, if I look at March 21 returns, I still have the time to file and the date has not passed by. You are trying to say 31st July does not come into picture only for the expiry date, because
I am saying till 31st July this section will not be in operation at all.
Chetan bhai, here the question is the which particular assessment years return you have to verify is the return which are already due and is over. If the due date is not yet come, that return is not to be verified or taken into consideration for previous 2 years. That is what the provision, I suppose. That is what the provision stands as of.
I'll do one thing. I'll just check the scenario again. I am also not too clear on this part. What I understand is even if the due date is later, 31st July, but if I'm still to pass, I can take a declaration, I suppose. I'll just come back to you on this. I'm not too clear on this.
But I'm doubtful, Hetal, as to the declaration part. I don't see that declaration will be a valid consideration when you default on the TDS part, because TDS department won't be accepting that declaration wherever it was allowed. It is already announced in the form of 15 form or 15HG and so on. I don't think there is such provision available. And if we take a declaration and take a risk, then it would be again a 217 default case. And we'll have to be checked again whether that SSC has filed the return subsequently or not and so on. Again, the interest liability will be there on the head of the deductor. I personally feel that will be a true stretch of the provision or a liberalizing or taking into the consideration a view which is beneficial to the tax deductor. But I don't see that is the intention of the government. They want to deduct, basically the idea is ki let the department want that ki more assessees to file the returns and claim the refund. If at all they are entitled, the government will decide and pay them the refund amount. That is what I understand.
So just to bring something, this we are talking of the transition provision, but what if in the next year, say from assessment year 22-23, so 1st April 22, I am liable to deduct TDS of the other person. Now for him, the due date will still be 31st July. He is not going to file a return on 1st April itself. So, you know, there'll be a similar problem here. So again, which 2 years to consider will become important like we were discussing. So let me just come back on this. As to what exact, which exact 2 years needs to be seen, what would be the right proposition?
Okay, I think the rest the other questions, from what I understand, you have covered Hetal very well. So what I will do is I will just So
hello. Hetal, there is one question on the 194P. We discuss about that if there is a share of profit or something.
Right.
Those should be also given a benefit too. I think that will be again too much stretch of the provision. the intention is only a small taxpayers who can be excluded from the filing proposition which is there in the law.
Right.
And they should not be put into the trouble having looked at their age factor and all. That is what the intention of the government, if they are on the retired income scheme like pension and all, and if they have only the interest income, like they have kept the money with the banks for their livelihood with respect to the FD or some fixed income schemes, then only I suppose that provisions will apply. All rest of the stretching of the provisions, I doubt myself, even if it is an exempt, you may have to file the return and get cleared from the department only. I don't think banks will take any chance on that.
Yeah, absolutely. It's one of the view possible. Like I discussed before, this view is definitely possible. And I agree with you, could be a possibility that bank might not want to. So
Coming to 194Q, the purchases, when I'm making and purchases or by making a payment of advances, do I have to deduct tax at that point of time or when the supply takes place? Because always it is whichever is earlier.
Correct.
Payment or credit to the particular supplier.
Right.
Now, if that is cancelled order subsequently, where do I stand? Whether that is to be reversed, how it is to be adjusted, just like in goods return we discuss.
Right.
The practical scenario would be a very big challenge. How do we adjust that TDS which is already deducted, but the transaction is totally cancelled, like no more supply from the supplier side because the contract is cancelled and so on. So what do we take a stand into that?
What I understand is, if it is possible for me to adjust that excess amount that I have, say for there's a cancellation and my TCS or TDS has already been done. If it is possible for me to adjust it against some other bank before filing the return of TDS, then I think I'll be able to do it. And if the return has been filed, if it is possible to even revise the return, maybe it's possible. But if not, then the only thing that remains is the other party to claim this and maybe keep a RICO as to why this transaction never happened. Because the other party will also have an issue in his 26 years where there'll be an income in his...
Very much true. One more scenario which I foresee is if there is an CIF transaction or a works contract transaction where the goods and services, both these are being supplied by a same supplier.
Right.
And there is no bifurcation, or if even if in some of the cases there is a bifurcation, say a machinery supply of 1 crore and there is an 2 lakhs of payment for an after sale services.
Right.
Now how do I take into consideration whether only 1 crore of machinery to be deducted at source and 2 lakhs to be separated out, or if it is a bundle of services and he is billing me a whole sum together, and in case of an CIF transaction, what happens to the insurance and freight which is being charged in the supply of the goods?
So going by the first question where we are saying it's an indivisible contract, so there could be a possibility where I know the components separately. If I know the components separately, then I will try to segregate services and goods and apply the respective section. But if I'm not being able to do that, then I need to really... So this was a similar issue under 194C also. When there was services, but then it was together with goods as well. So there, if it there's a view there that if it's a composite contract, not being able to bifurcate, then you have to deduct on the complete amount. I think we'll have to check in every scenario what is the major component, whether services is there and along with it materials are coming, or whether material is there and services coming along with it. So if it is more so in the nature of services, I think 194C comes in, then 194Q will not come because already TDS is there in 194C. But if it's more of a material and along with services, I think 194Q is on a higher weightage and that should be considered on a composite one. So this was in terms of your first query. Second was CIF. What I understand is 206C1H, there is a circular 1722 of 2020 which says that no adjustments should be made for removing these amounts from the sale amount. So I understand even for TDS under 194Q, these amounts will be considered. Though it's not the value of goods for the threshold limit, but for TDS purpose, yes, it should be considered.
That will include again the services which we already discussed, that is not the intention. Basically, they have used the word is in only goods.
Yeah, but there's a practical difficulty which we were otherwise also facing in 194C. So
I know it is always better that you ask for a deduction and pay to the government so that there won't be any disallowance subsequently. What happens to the higher purchase transactions, like when there is a purchase of some material or asset on higher purchase and it gets over only after a year's time or so in the next year? You don't know about that, whether this transaction will get complete fruitfully. Do I have to TDS them in advance when I'm making the first installment payment, or at the last installment when I really become an owner and the sale transaction gets completed?
So I have never reviewed or tested such kind of a transaction, but what I understand or what my view could be that the day there is a crystallization that I am going to be the owner and I'm going to purchase that transaction, I think that should be the year which should be considered for determining this TDS. Because like you said, on day one, I'm not aware, but at a later point in time, when it is crystallized that no, I'm going to be buying it out, then maybe yes, that time should be the time for it.
But that may turn out to be a subsequent year, or there may be an interim period where the contract may get cancelled also, may for many reasons. So how such transactions will be covered? I doubt 194Q point of view, when to make a TDS on such transactions.
So TDS, we are not saying will be on day one. No, it will be on the day when it crystallizes. So if you are saying that transaction is to get cancelled, then so it is not coming. The TDS will not come on that. No? I'm saying the TDS will be when it gets crystallized.
So crystallization will always be on the last installment when you make the payment to the supplier for the higher purchase. And that time, the ownership of this particular item gets transferred in the name of the buyer. Till that time, the ownership still remains with the supplier only.
So the event under the transaction, the event under the section is purchase or sale. But if that event is not there at all, or the on the first day when I'm doing that payment of higher purchase, then I think it should, we have
same,
a
same problem comes like in
sorry to interrupt, Mahendra. Can you please take this offline with the speaker? We'll just have this formal vote of thanks and we can close this meeting. Thank you so much, Mahendra bhai. Hital and Mahendra bhai, you can please connect offline. Parin, can you please, we move towards a formal vote of thanks. I request Parin to do the meeting.
Thanks, Chintan. And I thank Dadarish CP Study Circle for giving this opportunity to present a well-deserved hearty vote of thanks to CA Hital Gada. Hital has very well covered all the TDS and TCS new provisions, amendments, and all the clarifications which everyone was waiting for with comparison of 206 and 194 on TDS and TCS on sale of purchases and sale of goods, which has created a very well, we can say government has fully confused all the professionals as to how to, whether TDS will be applicable or TCS will be applicable or both will be applicable. So with that comparison and the queries, Hital has very well covered. Again, the challenges which she has highlighted, that the accountants will have a good challenge. And on the additional side, the professionals will also have a great challenge in while auditing and while verification of the TDS, TCS compliances for their clients. Hital, on behalf of the other CPA Study Circle, I propose a well-deserved vote of thanks to you. Thank you for accepting our invitation. And I request everyone to carry out it with a loud applause. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Hital. Thank you so much for your time.
Yeah.